moment, only in that relationship with our Heavenly Father do we find everything that satisfies us, and so He is our great priority.
Welcome to Corinth Baptist Church Sunday Worship Services with Pastor Teacher Joey Carroll.
When pastors fall into sin, they gouge out the road of the gospel. If you're born again, and yet you are unrepentant in sin and unwilling to deal with sin in your life, you're gouging out the road to advance the gospel.
Amen. A little bit different this morning than what I normally do. We're not going to jump back into Acts and continue walking. I wanted to take the opportunity that we had to talk about two pictures of the gospel this morning that we have before us. Pearson has already painted just a lovely portrait of the gospel for us this morning, and I want to walk through that, and then we'll walk through the Lord's Supper and the portrait that it paints for us. So this morning I want you to reflect on just how much loved you are and what great things God has done for us in moving us from death into life. So let's talk about what we just saw for just a second. Let's talk about baptism. Let's go back to our Lord's baptism. And it's recorded for us in the Gospels, all the Gospels, but I love Matthew's story the best. And you don't have to turn there this morning. You'll remember it. Matthew 3, our Lord Jesus comes into Galilee, and He approaches John, who was baptizing people with water for repentance. And He tells John, He says, "I want to be baptized." And John, in just same fashion as we would, "Now I'm not baptizing you. You need to baptize me." It's very interesting what Jesus says to him. He says in Matthew 3:15, He says, "Permit it at this time, for in this way it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness." And then He permitted him. In other words, why was Jesus baptized? Jesus was baptized in obedience to the Father. Everything our Lord ever did, He did in 100% obedience to what the Father commanded Him to do. And so even the Lord Jesus submitted Himself to be baptized by John. After Him being baptized, it says in 3:16, Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened, and He saw the Spirit of God descending as a dove and lighting on Him. And behold, a voice out of the heavens said, "This is My beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." And so we learned three things, actually, in this passage about why Jesus was baptized. First one, let me back way out and talk about the fact of its placement in the Gospel of Matthew. Right after Jesus was baptized, He was carried off into the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights where He was tempted by Satan. He immediately returns from the wilderness, walks right back into Galilee where He was baptized, and begins preaching the gospel. So the baptism for Jesus inaugurated His mission. When He walked into Galilee to be baptized, it was the beginning of 3 years of an amazing ministry culminated on the cross and then His resurrection. So His baptism inaugurated His public ministry or His mission. Again, His baptism was an act of obedience, setting us an example to follow. But lastly, we see here in this last verse, a voice out of heaven came, being that of the Father, "This is My beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." It was an audible response, according to the text, of God the Father affirming the Son and rejoicing in the Son. It was an audible affirmation and a rejoicing of His Son. So Jesus was obedient in His baptism. He inaugurated His public ministry or His mission, and we saw an audible response from the Father. Now let's go to Pearson's baptism. And you'll notice the exact same things. Pearson's baptism was a necessary act, not for salvation, but for obedience. Pearson was obedient to the commands of the Father. No more than God needed to be saved in His baptism did Pearson need to be saved in his baptism. He did it out of obedience. Second thing we see about Pearson's baptism and his public profession of faith, it doesn't necessarily inaugurate his mission. Rather, it inaugurates his submission to the lordship of Jesus Christ. He just made it public that he has given his life to Jesus Christ as his Lord, and he is now going to follow the Lord and submit to the Lord and to submit to the Word of God. We just saw a public testimony of I submit myself to Christ, just like our Lord Jesus did. It began his mission, and it began Pearson's submission. And then last, we saw in our Lord's baptism an audible response from God. Now, did we hear that this morning? Well, in fact, we did hear an audible voice from the church of God. Did you notice that? And we always do. The moment someone comes up out of the baptismal waters, hands begin to clap. I can hear from there, praise the Lord. I can hear amen. And it's the exact same thing. And here we just confess and affirm our brother in Christ, and we rejoice with him as being one of us now. And so in obedience and in inauguration and then in the response, we celebrate baptism just in the same way as our Lord Jesus did. It is an absolute beautiful picture. There is no difference. Baptism, though, is a part of our responsibility as the church of God. It is something that we have been commanded to do. Remember Matthew 28? All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and then teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. This is our mission statement. We don't need another one. It's extraordinarily quite simple and plain. It doesn't matter if we go to Myanmar or Malaysia or Louisville or across the street. Our mission as a church is to make disciples or fully devoted followers of Christ, baptizing them and teaching them. And so that's what we are to do as a church. But in this Great Commission process, I want you to realize, though, that there are actually two baptisms that take place. And this is where so many people get confused. There is a spiritual baptism and a physical baptism. Let me talk about the spiritual baptism. It's the one that saves. It's the one that is accomplished solely by the grace of God. It's the one that Paul refers to in Ephesians 1:13. Look what Paul says. In Christ, you also, after listening to the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Now watch this. Having also believed, you were sealed in him with the Holy Spirit of promise. Standing side by side, it fits the grammar, it fits the Greek, it fits the English. At the moment you believed, at the moment Austin believed, at the moment Pearson believed, at the moment each one of us, if we have believed, we were sealed at that moment with the Holy Spirit. It occurred simultaneously at a moment of salvation. It occurs at the moment of conversion. It occurs at the moment of justification. It's a spiritual baptism. It's a renewal. It's a rebirth. And it's solely accomplished by the grace of God. You've been born again if you believe. And we'll talk about this in just a minute. But Pearson was raised to a newness of life. His life will begin to look different now, because he has been born again by the Spirit of God. John refers to the two baptisms in this way, or the spiritual baptism rather, in Matthew 3:11. He says, as for me, I baptize with water for repentance, but he who is coming after me, he is mightier than I, in reference to Christ. I'm not fit to remove his sandals, in fact, he says. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. And that's what took place. The very moment you believed, your spiritual baptism. Now, we just walked through Acts 10 a few weeks ago, and you remember the Acts 10. Peter goes to the very first Gentile house. God miraculously leads him to Cornelius' house. Peter never been into a Gentile house. God wants him to preach the gospel to the Gentiles. And so Peter walks into this Gentile house, that meaning not being a Jew, and begins to preach the gospel. In Acts 10:44, it says, while Peter was still speaking these words, in other words, he didn't even get to his invitation, the Holy Spirit fell upon those who were listening to the message, and all the Jews who came with Peter were amazed because the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles also, for they were seeing them speaking in tongues and exalting God. Then Peter answered, listen to this, surely no one can refuse the water for these to be baptized who have received the Holy Spirit just as we did, can he? And he ordered them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Cornelius' house, we see it all mapped out. There's a spiritual baptism, and because of the spiritual baptism, there is an obedient physical baptism in water. And the error of many is not to see the spiritual one, and therefore they misunderstand the significance of the physical one. But Scripture is plain. So let's talk about the physical one. Let's go back to what we just saw, the picture that Pearson paints. In fact, Pearson's already preached the gospel this morning, in case you weren't paying attention. Because we started out in death. In fact, Ephesians 2 says, and you were dead in your trespasses and sins. If you'll notice how we started out with the baptism, Pearson was submersed. It's a picture of being buried. It's a picture of death. It's a picture of absolute helplessness. It's a picture of I can't do anything to remedy or help my situation. I am dead. And here's another thing that's really confused in the Southern Baptist Church. We don't understand dead. It's pretty clear. Dead is dead. Ask Dustin. He never gets anybody half dead. If he does, he probably runs out the back door. They're dead. A lot of people say, well, they still have their mind. Well, no, wait till we get to Ephesians 2 in a few weeks. Your mind is dead. You're dead in your sins and your trespasses. In fact, the Greek word is nekros, which we translate into corpse. That's what it literally says. And you were a corpse. And there's nothing a corpse can do. And that's what Pearson was showing under the water. There's no life. It's gone. He was dead in his trespasses and sins, and his death results in a separation from God. Now, if I want to mention this, because I'm going to talk about life, but let me talk about grace for just a second. Because you know if I get on grace, I'm going to spend a whole hour there. So let me just say this briefly. He didn't raise himself. Someone outside of him raised him from death to life. If you're one of those that thinks that Jesus has done all he's going to do and the rest is up to you, brother, you need to baptize yourself. Because you're not really dead. If you're dead, you need grace to raise you. Now let's talk about life. Pearson was raised out of that death into newness of life. Ephesians 2 again, verse 4. But God, and that's the most beautiful two words in the whole of the Bible, being rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our transgressions, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved and raised us up with Christ. By the grace of God, you went from death to life like that. In the moment you believe, you understood grace in all of its fullness, and someone outside of you, i.e., the blessed Lord, through the power of the Holy Spirit, raised you from death to life. Romans 6 puts it this way. We have been buried with Christ through baptism into death, and so that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so that we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have become united with Christ in his death, certainly we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. Meaning, 1 Corinthians 15, Jesus was raised from the dead in bodily form. You know what that means for Pearson? And me? And you? When our Lord returns, we will be resurrected in bodily form. Amen. and we will walk in that new life. But today, we can participate in the new life because we already have the Holy Spirit. And so we can walk in newness of life. You always get pictures, physical pictures of this in Scripture. The physical picture of this reality is in John 11. Lazarus is dead. He's been in the tomb for 4 days. One of Jesus' best friends. 4 days dead. He walks up to the tomb and he simply says, "Lazarus," with a loud voice, "come forth." And the dead man came out of the tomb. If you ever want to explain, you know, we can never put that to words. Pearson, you'll never be able to explain what happened to you. The best way to put it is, I was dead and God called my name. And a dead man came to life. God called my name. And many of you are shaking your heads because you remember when, don't you? When the Spirit of God began to deal with you and He called your name. And you came out of a tomb, being dead, now being raised to life. That is the grace of God. And it's a beautiful thing. I know I've told you this before, but every time I go through this, it just pops in my head. I asked a crowd one time, I said, what was Lazarus? I was trying to get dead in their mind, right? I said, what was Lazarus doing in the tomb for 4 days? And one lady said, he was praying. I was like, no, he was dead. He wasn't doing anything. He was dead. And Jesus called his name. We got to move on. Let's go to our second picture this morning of life and death. And I want to turn our attention to the Lord's Supper table. For in it we have another glorious picture of the gospel, okay? Now when we start talking about meals and we're about to participate in a physical and spiritual meal, there's four great meals in the Bible. Two in the old, two in the new, okay? In fact, the Bible begins with a meal and the Bible ends with a meal. Now for the sake of time, I only want to talk about the meal that begins in the Old Testament and the meal that begins with the gospel, okay? The one in the Old Testament was a physical meal, and you'll understand this. The one in the New Testament is a spiritual meal. But unfortunately, both meals revolve around death. Both of these meals are centered around death. Now let's talk about the first meal that takes place right at the start of your Bible. This first meal took place in a beautiful garden. This first meal took place at the foot of a fruit tree. It could not have been a more beautiful setting, totally unaffected by sin. It was the most beautiful place that has ever been on earth. However, this meal was, listen, taken in defiance. It was taken in defiance. God had placed man in the middle of the garden. In Genesis 2, the Lord God commanded the man, saying, "From any tree in the garden you can eat freely, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in that day that you eat of it, you will surely die." So I want this to stick in your brain, because I'll come back to it. How many trees could they eat from in the garden? All of them, save one. And in absolute defiance, Adam pulled up a table and a chair at the foot of that one tree he was not supposed to eat from, and he ate and took in defiance. The Lord God walked in the garden shortly thereafter, and he asked him the question, "Have you eaten from the tree of which I have commanded you not to eat?" And then he pronounced judgment upon them, and he concludes with these words, "For you are dust, and to dust you shall return." So Adam and Eve took a meal in defiance, which resulted into death, which resulted into judgment, and then resulted into death. And it wasn't just a physical death that they were going to experience. It was a spiritual death. It was a separation from God that was going to last for all eternity. It was a meal taken in defiance that resulted in death and a price that they could never pay. Now let's talk about the meal that takes place at the very beginning of your New Testament. It's a very different meal. It was not a meal taken in defiance. It was a meal given in obedience. Let's compare the two. Rather than at the foot of a lovely fruit tree, this meal was provided at the foot of a horrific and cruel tree, namely the cross. Rather than the scene being in a beautiful garden, this scene was set on a barren hill and was a place of torture and death. If there's never been a more beautiful place than the Garden of Eden, I would tell you that you could very easily find Golgotha, walk outside of the city of Jerusalem, and begin to search for the hill that is the most barren, ugliest, most fretful place you could find, and you would more than likely find the place where they hung our Lord, crucified our Lord. This was not a physical meal. This was a spiritual meal. Again, it was not taken in defiance, but it was rather willingly given in obedience. This first meal resulted in a debt we could not pay, yet the cross of our Lord was a spiritual meal which paid all of our debts. The first meal resulted in death for all mankind. And look at this second meal. The first meal condemned us all to death. This second meal, there was a single death. A single death that resulted in salvation for all those who would believe and come to His table and eat. The life of our Lord was given in your place, and now He invites you to His table to eat. Isaiah 55 puts it this way: "Everyone who is thirsty, come to the waters. You who have no money, come, buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money, without cost." And then he asks this question: "Why do you spend money for what is not bread and your wages for what does not satisfy?" In other words, why are you still eating at the table of defiance? Why do you pour sin into your mouth and shove food of sin into your mouth and continue to swallow? Why do you do that? You don't have to do that. That table will lead you to death. And you know in your heart, whatever you're eating, it does not satisfy you. I don't care if it's immorality. I don't care if it's money. I don't care if it's drugs. I don't care if it's alcohol. Why are you eating that? You know you're empty. There's a table you can eat at that will satisfy you. I went to lunch this week with a guy that I haven't seen in probably 7 or 8 years. Used to go to church with him. I knew he had fallen way into sin just by looking at him. He said, "Well, hang on, no, really. He used to be my size. Now he can bench press 400 pounds. Goes to the tanning bed every day. I know what's going on. Driving a sports car." And I said, "What are you doing with your life?" And he laughed. And he says, "I'm enjoying all the immorality that I can get." And he began to tell me, and I said, "Whoa, whoa, whoa, I don't want to hear any of that." I said, "Have you forgotten what the Lord has done on your behalf?" And he started to laugh at me. I said, "Have you forgotten what God has done in the love?" He said, "God's never loved me." He said, "I tell you what I found." In laughing, he began to describe his immorality again. And I stopped him in the middle of it. And I said, "You look at me and tell me that you're satisfied." And he stopped and his smile fell off his face. He looked me dead in the eye and he said, "No, I'm not satisfied." And I said, "And you're empty, aren't you?" And he said, "Yes, I'm empty." I said, "What's wrong with you then? If you're doing what you want to do, why are you so empty? Why aren't you satisfied?" He said, "I don't know." And I said, "I'll tell you exactly why it is. Because the only one that can satisfy your heart is the Lord Jesus Christ. And until you sit down at His table and eat what He offers, you will go through life so hungry for the next bite. And it'll never satisfy you." You know I'm telling you the truth. I don't care what it is. You eat and you eat and you eat and you eat. And you can't wait to sit down and eat again because you can never get full. And yet Christ offers you a table that will satisfy. Isaiah continues on right after he asks the question, why do you spend wages for do not satisfy? He says, listen carefully to me. Eat what is good. Delight yourself in abundance. Listen, incline your ear and come to me. Listen that you may live. Some of you need to walk away from the table of sin because it will not satisfy you. And sit down at the table of Christ because it will fill you with joy. Let me give you two words of warning and then we will come to the table this morning. Two words of warning and then invitation. Our first word of warning is this. This meal that our Lord has provided for us through the cross is the only meal that can give you forgiveness of sins and eternal life. Now, I'm not talking about this doesn't save you, okay? I'm talking spiritually. And now let me ask you again. How many trees could you eat from in the garden? All of them but one. If you want to be saved, how many trees can you eat from? The tree of the cross. If you want everlasting life, there's only one meal in town you can eat. There's only one tree that you can pull the fruit off from and satisfy yourself. The gospel has turned everything upside down. We used to have all the options and we rejected all the options and we chose the one tree to condemn us. And now God comes back and he says, if you eat from any other tree, you'll die. But if you eat from the fruit of the cross, you'll live. Jesus puts it this way in John 6, arguing with some religious people. He says, truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in yourselves. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. My flesh is the true food, and my blood is the true drink. Who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, I live, and because of the Father, so he who eats me will also live. This, he says of himself, is the bread which came down of heaven. Not as our fathers ate and died. He who eats this bread will live forever. It's a metaphor. We don't eat his flesh and drink his blood. He's saying, I provided a meal for you on the cross. Now come to the table and eat. And if you eat, you will have life in me. That's the picture. So the first warning is this. There's only one tree. You have to eat from his tree. Second warning, don't think you can eat and leave. Sand Mountain has provided its fair share of charlatans and false preachers. We've had more hands raised and more aisles walked and more prayers prayed than anywhere I've ever been in my life, and I've yet to meet somebody that did not think they're going to heaven, or that did not think they were going anywhere but heaven, rather. They did something once upon a time. Don't you realize that's Catholicism? That's exactly what that is. I did something. Therefore, I am going to heaven. And we've got people all over this mountain trusting in something they did. Some preacher led them in something. But don't you remember Pearson's picture? He was dead. Somebody outside of him raised him by the grace of God into newness of life. It is by grace you're born again. Psalms 34:8 says this, taste and see that the Lord is good. How blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. In other words, continues to find his satisfaction in Jesus. Listen, if you think that you did something once upon a time and you have no love for God, no love for his word, could give a rip about obeying the word of God, just like my friend said this week who professed faith 15 years ago. If you're in that state, friend, you've been deceived. You've been misled. I'm sorry, you've not been born again. Which table are you eating at this morning? I say there's three. First of all, there's the table of defiance. It's the individual who sits in their sin and thinks they enjoy it. But if you really get to asking them, they understand that they're not satisfied. They have to eat and eat and eat and eat and eat and eat. But they continue eating because they're in defiance to God. Second table, the table of deception. You're that individual that I was just speaking of. You think you stole something from the Lord's table, and then you slipped back out into life to live it exactly how you were living it before. You've been deceived, and you know you have. You know you have not been born again by the grace of God. So in your mind, you stole something one day off the table of life. You stuffed it in your mouth, and you went right back out and turned to your old ways of living in sin. You're sitting at the table of deception. The last table is the table of our Lord. Many of you have tasted of the Lord, and He's good. And you found that that's the only table that can satisfy you to eat at. And even though every now and then you find yourself kind of walking away a little bit and getting something off the table of the world, and you taste it and it's sweet for a second in your mouth, y'all know what I'm talking about, and then all of a sudden it gets down in your stomach and it sours your stomach, and all of a sudden guilt fills up in your heart, and you're like, why did I ever take that and eat that? It's like crystals, right? You go to Crystal, it's like, man, this is the best tasted stuff on the planet. Then it gets down to your stomach. You think, I'm going to die. Why did I ever go there? Y'all know what I'm talking about. We all do that sometimes, don't we? We go over to Crystal, and it's good for just like that. It's so good. And then it gets here, and you're like, that was not good. I got to get back to the table of the Lord. That's where I belong. So as we come to the table this morning, I want to do a number of things. Holly, Robbie, you guys come on up with Pearson. Sit right here. Dustin, Brittany, Austin, you come on up. Sit right here with your parents. They are about to take in their first Lord's Supper. Is there room for all y'all right on one? And this is an extraordinary time. And I'm going to serve them. But for the rest of you, we're about to prepare. And most of you know what that means. You're going to bow your head and you're going to enter into solemn prayer. Now here's the deal. For those of you who have eaten at the table of the Lord and you enjoy the table of the Lord, just examine your life and make sure you haven't been to Crystal lately, okay? Make sure you're still enjoying eating at the Lord's table. And if there's repentance that needs to be done, just repent in your heart. Confess that sin before God and then enjoy the picture we're going to paint. Not the reality, the picture. Others of you may be sitting at the table of deception and you know in your heart. Now I'm sorry, I've said all I can say, but you know in your heart you're empty. And you know more than likely you've never been born again. And in your heart, I want you, if the Spirit of God is leading you, to repent and put your faith and trust in Christ. And if you do that, please, I want you to come even while we're praying and find a seat up here on the front, and we will spiritually feed you what Christ just did in your heart. Third, if you're sitting at the table of defiance, you've never tasted of the Lord, but you know that the Spirit of God is dealing with you about your sin, I encourage you to leave the table of defiance. You know it will never satisfy you. Repent and trust in the tree of our Lord, in the cross of Christ and what He's done. And if you do that, come up front and sit, and we'll feed you based upon your profession. There is no test, okay? So if I could have my deacons come forward, please, and sit right here.